This is going to be weird. Can you hear me on Facebook now? Oh, yes, you can. Because I can hear myself. Is it going to be double face? There's got to be a way to fix this. Oh, that is funny. Yeah, okay. That's funny. Okay. Where's my Facebook? There it is. I don't even think this is true. This might not work. What's up, Maria? What's up, Sophia? Can you guys on Zoom hear me twice? I'm sorry. I'm gonna fix it. How about now? How's that, Zoom? Can you hear me twice? Oh, more people coming in. Maria is here. Erica's here. I'm going to do one last check on Facebook, and if it's not working, I'm going to exit out. One last check on Facebook. I think it's working. Yeah, it is. Yay. Okay. All right, let's get started. Anybody else? All right, how many people got in here? 16? Cool. Make sure I record.
Recording in progress.
Okay, what is up? So good to see you guys. So before we get started, if you're watching on Facebook or on YouTube, this is our weekly call for the Strong for Summer Bootcamp. This general topic that we're going to talk about today is just so important, and I really wanted to kind of treat you guys by sharing it with you. The only people on the Zoom call live are those that are in the bootcamp, and the only people eligible for the prize that we're going to talk about are the people who are in the bootcamp. And I'll mostly be talking directly to them the majority of the time. So if you hear like me talking about the app and like your program, et cetera, just please know that this is a Strong for Summer Bootcamp call, and these are my people, but this topic is so widely needed, I feel, and so we're going to share it with the world. So first of all, I'm Jamie, personal trainer, level 1 and 2 certified nutrition coach. I run Strength by Jamie Barroso. This business has been for about 8 years now. As a collective team, we have tons of certifications in all the stuff, but the main thing is the experience that we have training and helping people really change their view and their lifestyle around nutrition and fitness. We like to say that we love to help people learn how to lift, look like they lift, and love how they feel. with the backing of science and sustainability. All right, so this week we'll start off with the challenge that we were doing. So in the Facebook group this week, it has been, oh good, thank you, Jennifer, for letting me know that. In the Facebook group, we were doing the meal share challenge. You guys killed that. I absolutely loved seeing all of your, I got some inspiration. I think a lot of other people got inspiration. I mean, Michelle's bulgogi recipe was like, yes, please. So that was awesome. Thank you guys for participating. I have a winner. I just went through randomly. I put everybody's name in a hat and I pulled one. So I have a winner. That person, I mixed up the prizes. So I know that in the challenge document, I had all the prizes listed. I mixed them up. I changed them. I decided this week I want to give away a food scale because I want the person to have the digital food scale in time for the challenge next week, which is going to be a tracking challenge. And actually that challenge starts technically like today. So from today, Thursday, till next week, next Thursday, it's going to be a tracking challenge. So essentially you're going to be tracking your intake on MyFitnessPal or on Chronometer or whatever else you want to use and sharing your like end of day tracking, a screenshot of it. You can share it in the group. You can share just a screenshot of a meal you tracked. If you're still getting used to it, but you did really well on like one meal, then you can share that. If I can close the screen. Yep, I can. Cool. So next week, yeah, it's going to be a tracking challenge. And I want you to have the food scale for that. So the hashtag is going to be hashtag tracking challenge. If anybody watching on Facebook or on YouTube wants to participate, you are more than welcome. We would love to have you participate in the tracking challenge. Please do. If you do, if I notice people participating who are not in the bootcamp, then I'll pull somebody for free coffee Friday on next Friday. So please participate and one of you might get a free coffee. But the prize up for grabs this week for our boot campers is going to be a Halo watch. So that's the Amazon smartwatch. So we're going to be giving one of those away on this call next Thursday. So for this week, for the meal share challenge, the winner is, and I'm not sure if she's here or not, but drum roll, please. Erica Hayden. Erica, awesome. So Erica, what you need to do is just shoot me a message either on Facebook or shoot me an email with your home address and I will send you your digital food scale. Yay, she is here. You're welcome. You're welcome. You're welcome. Okay, today we're talking about foundations. This is the topic of this call, is the foundations. Now, something that's different about us, or I like to believe is different about us than most other coaches, trainers, the general dieting and fitness industry, is that we're not going to BS you, okay? We tend to tell it like it is. Love it or hate it, we tell you like it is. There's a lot that is in your control, like a lot. Way more than you probably give yourself credit for. There's also some stuff that's outside of your control, right? Like your genetics. Like sometimes if you're a parent, your ability to get a full night's sleep. Your stress, you might not be able to completely eliminate stress from your life and you feel like that's very much out of your control, right? And the fact of the matter is this lifestyle is hard. It is hard. It's always going to be hard. It's hard in the beginning. It's hard in the middle. It's hard all the way down to the end. Hopefully there is no end, right? Other than, you know, passing away at a very old age because you made it your lifestyle. But it's hard. And the truth is that it's harder for some than it is for others, right? Some people have more barriers than others, whether it's lifestyle or whether it's hormones or whether it's genetics. And the truth also is that literally everyone will have a different results and a different response to the same hard work based on your genetics. Okay. So I could take every single one of you in this boot camp. I could put you in a controlled environment and make sure that you do all of the things. You eat the macros. You eat the macros. You exercise properly. I train you. I'm in there with you, making sure you're deadlifting properly and making sure you're progressing properly. And I'm making sure that you're walking and I'm forcing it on you, right? And every single one of you would still respond differently. Some of you would have massive weight loss. Some of you would have very little. Some of you would have massive strength gains. Some of you would have very little. It's just the facts, okay? And a good trainer or good coach is going to help you not only work around those things that are different to help you still see progress, but a good coach is also going to make sure that you understand that this is not all about those aesthetic results. The reason you're doing this is not 100% just to lose those 10, 20, 30 pounds. Okay. You can be wonderfully happy in your body. You can be wonderfully healthy on all of the scales that you need to be healthy on. And you can still have a body that looks different than somebody next to you. Okay. You can lift and love this lifestyle and have a space in this world and not fit a specific like way that you feel like you have to look. Okay. So it's a combination of doing things in a way that are going to get results for you, but also understanding that you are you and you are your unique self. And even in doing all of the quote unquote right things, you still might get different results than somebody else. And that is just the way it is. And I'm not going to BS you on that, but that's a wonderful thing because once we finally accept that, I actually see the most success with clients when they finally accept this. And the truth is, I was scared for a very long time to talk about this because my fear is everybody else is not talking about that, right? The fitness industry is not talking about that. Other coaches and trainers, they don't talk about that because it's not sexy and it doesn't sell their programs and it doesn't sell their diets because they want you to believe that if you do this way, then you are going to get the results. And that's how they sell it. But the truth is, when you can finally let go of these insanely ridiculous expectations you might have on yourself. And sure, you still want progress. You might still want weight loss. You might still want to look like you lift and have awesome biceps and have your quads pop, you know, all the things. Being able to understand that your results might take harder work. It might be harder for you than somebody else, or it might be easier for you than somebody else, or your genetic potential is different than somebody else. And understanding that and doing it anyway and loving it anyway is so freaking powerful. And that is where we see success. Okay. That is where we see continued success. So as something I really want you guys to understand. All right. I also want you to know it's not always hard. All right. I talk about this being super, super hard, but it's not always that. It's always hard. It's always challenging, but it's not always so frontal cortex challenging, right? When you are learning to balance all of these various things, like your steps and your training and your nutrition and your blah, 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 blah. It requires so much brain energy, right? I mean, it's like, it feels like every second you're thinking about this and it's exhausting, but stick with it because it changes. Okay. If you have a good mindset, if you agree to play the long game, and if you really aim to fall in love with the process and go slow and make it sustainable, it becomes so much easier, so easy that it's almost second nature. And that's what a lot of us want. There are so many conversations I have with people where I'm like, what are your goals? It's always my question. What's your goal? What's your short-term goal? What would you like to see, you know, soon? And what's your long-term goal? What do you ultimately imagine yourself being in 6 to 12 months? And the most common thing I hear is, I just want this to be normal for me. I want to eat a salad because I enjoy it. I want to be that person that goes for a jog on vacation because they felt like it, or goes to the gym even when they don't had a hard day, but because it's just the routine. Like, I want to be that. And so you have to dedicate yourself to the initial process and getting through the hard shit. and eventually you will get there, and it is so freaking worth it. Right. But anything new takes practice. So if you really, really wanted to be a skier, you would expect the same thing, right? If you really, really wanted to be like a mountain bike rider, you would expect the same thing. So I'm not asking for anything crazy here, but sometimes we forget that with this kind of stuff, it's the same. It's practice, right? But no matter what, you have to master the foundations, no matter your genetics, no matter your story, no matter your reasons, no matter, you know, no matter what, you have to master the foundation. So that's what we're going to talk about today. Okay. And I have a really fun visual. And if you've been around here long enough, you've probably seen this visual before. So hang with me and watch again, because it's a good one. All right. So I've got rocks. Angle my screen so you can see my rocks. Can you see my rocks? Oh, Elizabeth's here. I missed her. Make sure I get everybody in. Sorry, Elizabeth. I don't know how long you were sitting there. Elizabeth's definitely seen this analogy. Okay, so I got rocks. Okay, and these rocks represent the foundations. These rocks represent whole foods and food quality and general nutrition, right? This one represents, and there's not any particular size for what they represent. It's just what I grabbed. This one represents strength training, resistance training of some sort. Let's do this one. Represents movement. So this is steps. This is overall activity. This is cardiovascular. This is any other kind of movement you do with your body outside of your strength training. This is stress management. And it's flat because I know that you spread yourself thin. But I'm... Okay. So this is stress management. This one is sleep. Okay. And this one is hydration. These are the foundations. Really, really simple. All right. And now I have here, I have a jar of sand, but it's not sand. I'll tell you what it is. It's a mixture of quinoa and chia seeds because my husband was trying really hard to help me consolidate the pantry. And he saw that there weren't many chia seeds left in the container. And so he took the chia seeds and he proceeded to dump them in the quinoa container because he got mixed up which one was which. And now I don't know what to do because that's a very odd mixture. Like, you can't cook it. But I also don't want to eat raw quinoa. It's just sitting in my pantry. And my sand out back that I actually have is wet. So we're using quinoa and chia. And it has a purpose. You'll see. This sand, I'm going to call it sand for the purpose of this. This sand is the little shit. This is all the little shit. This is supplements. This is meal timing, intermittent fasting, rep ranges, training frequency, the exact program you're doing or the exact person you follow on YouTube or that Instagram workout. This is macros, carbs, and fats, and playing macro Tetris and trying to make everything fit perfectly. This is low fat, low carb. This is everything else. That's this. Okay. Now, in your life, this is what a lot of people do. This is what a lot of people do. They start with the little shit and they just pour it right in. And then they find that their results are kind of lacking because they didn't focus on the foundation. So then they go back and they try to start shoving them in there. And guess what happens when you try to start shoving the foundations in when you've prioritized the little shit? There's no room for them. There's no room for them and you're going to be unsuccessful. I wish, you know what? If I tried hard enough, this jar would break. And that would be a really great analogy. You break your jar. You would break your jar of life. So I know you know where I'm going with this. The ultimate way to do this is you start with the foundations. And we're going to talk about each one as I place it in the jar. And now I don't remember which rock represents which thing, but I do know that this one is stress management. It's the only one I remember. So let's start with strength training. Getting that, some kind of strength training or resistance training in, no matter what it is, whether it is, now, obviously there is optimal of all of these things. There is an optimal way to do it. But if you focus too hard on the optimal when you're not ready, because you haven't figured out how to master the foundation of it, then you're going to kick yourself in the butt. You're going to kick yourself in the rear. Okay. So a lot of people are already strength training, but they might not be doing it optimally. If you're already strength training, you're not doing it optimally. That's a quick, easy fix. But the fact of the matter is you're already doing it. And that is one rock in the jar. And that is awesome. So some sort of resistance training, some sort of strength training. And then we have food quality. Okay. A lot of people, a very high amount of people, tend to go right from doing jack shit with their diet to playing macro Tetris. And you can tell me in the comments if you have done this before. You're all over the place, eating whatever you want, whenever you want, with not paying attention at all, to going and getting your macros calculated and trying to meet your protein, your carbs, and your fats every single day. And at the end of the day, you're left with like, I got 20 grams of fat left and you know, 40 grams of protein and 1 gram of carb. What the heck can I eat? And you're like, dude, are you serious? So that's not what you should be doing. You should be focusing on your food quality, making sure 80 to 90% of what you eat is whole foods, making sure you're having protein at most meals and veggie at protein at every meal, veggies at most meals, and mastering that before you go into crazy macro tracking. And then even then, I greatly argue that you don't need to pay attention to carbs and fats. Majority of people don't need to play macro Tetris. They just need to get enough calories, get enough protein, and focus on high quality whole food so you can get enough fiber in your diet. Okay. So focusing on just your nutritional quality is a big one that a lot of people miss. Okay. They go right to tracking and then they're tracking Oreos all day and wondering why they're fucking hungry. So that's, you know, that's just the reality of it. The next one is movement. You got to move. You can't just go work out, go to spin class or go to your strength training class or go in the gym and get your workout done and then sit like a blob for the rest of the day. I mean, you can, you will thrive and you will function. You will survive, I should say, but you won't thrive. It won't be optimal. You need to move. You need to get some sort of movement in. We like to say 7 to 12K steps. Are steps the magical thing? No, but it's just general idea of that's how often you're moving your body. This can be in forms of just getting out and walking regularly, trying to get up, take the stairs, park in the back of the parking lot, all those cliche things. It can also mean getting in cardiovascular activity, going to hop on the elliptical during your lunch break because it feels good, not because you're trying to burn extra calories, but because your body needs the movement, okay? Getting that foundation down and finding a way to fit it into your lifestyle. All right. I'm going to get into some fun ones now. By fun, I mean boring. Hydration. You need to be hydrated. I mean, I don't need to talk too much about that. Just drink your water. Okay. Capiche? Cool. Next one is sleep. Parents, I know it's hard. I was just talking to somebody about this the other day. We're having a call and we were talking about how there's going to be a lot that's outside of your control, right? We talked about that earlier, but there's also a lot that's inside your control. And sleep might be outside of your control for some of you, for parents, for people who are still managing stress, for people who just freaking wake up every 2 hours and you don't know why. There's not much you can do, right? But there still is something you can do. I'm sure there are areas that you can improve your chances of getting sleep. Could you go to bed 30 to 60 minutes earlier? Could you sleep in a little bit longer, and cancel your 1 hour of, Instagram scrolling? Could you keep your room a little bit darker? Could you set some limits with your spouse so they don't do the crap they do that wakes you up when you don't want to be woken up, right? Is there something you can do to improve your sleep? And guaranteed for every single one of you that thinks there's nothing, that their sleep is screwed, there's something you can do to improve your chances, even if you can't completely take control of it. Okay. But it is important. And then the last one, stress management. Again, this is something where there's a lot of you that might not be able to eliminate stress from your life. That's ideal. If you can eliminate the stress, that's my favorite like recommendation right now is try to eliminate stress from your life. If you can't, i.e., you have a high stress job or you have multiple children that stress you the F out, understandable. But you need, again, you have some control. So this is where you can implement some stress management strategies. So whether it's yoga, whether it's meditation, whether it's going on a jog or taking a 30 minutes by yourself in your room when you get home from work before you interact with your kids, whether it's getting better sleep, whether it's, I don't know, listening to music and having a glass of wine, there are stress management skills that you can probably implement to help you come down from those high stress situations. We talked about this yesterday. A cold shower, an ice bath, literally, those things really help with coming down from stressful situations because it forces this breathing pattern. So there's things that you can do. Even if you can't completely control it, there are things you can do to help make it a little bit more optimal, right? So those are the foundations. And once you've got those covered and you do really well at them, and you don't have to be perfect, like you don't have to completely manage your stress before you add in the little shit. But once you've got all these things down, if you then want to take it up a notch, this is where you add in the little shit. And if you'll notice, when I add in the little shit after I do the foundations, everything fits in the jar. Okay. Everything fits in the jar. And I love this analogy so much because it is such a great visual of how we do things backwards, right? We tend to do things backwards. So until you have mastered the foundations, you should not be worrying about any of the little shit because guaranteed the little shit's not going to get you results. The foundations are going to get you results. Capiche? I hope you liked my analogy. I always have fun when I do that one. Let me clean up my table and answer any questions before I move on. Do you guys have any thoughts or questions about that? Let me check my chat box real quick here. Awesome. Cool. Glad that resonated with you. Guilty. Thanks for sharing. You're welcome. Facebook has sounds. Good. I'm really glad because otherwise this would have been this would have been really boring. Thoughts on working out, not feeling well. Christy, you're supposed to be in the Zoom. Why are you watching on Facebook? Calling you out, girl. That's okay. I can see your comments way better on speaking to your soul. Oreo hashtag Oreos. Oreos fit in the jar. I want you to know that. Quality nutrition, remember what I always say is 80-20, 90-10, somewhere in there. Awesome. Christy, ask your question again at the end because I don't want to get derailed, but I'll go into that in a sec. Working out when you're not feeling well. I have some thoughts on that. But let me finish what I was gonna say because otherwise I'll get off and I gotta find my notes now. It's like, where was I going? Okay, so kind of shifting gears a little bit from that general thing. So we kind of talked about foundation. So something I want to address in this particular boot camp, and to anybody that's watching, this is definitely applicable. There's somebody here that's going to know exactly what I'm talking about. There's two people here that are going to know exactly what I'm talking about. Stick to the program. Stick to the program as it's intended. And the reason I say that is because there's a lot of people that kind of come into these kind of challenges and boot camps, And what they're used to is they're used to getting just like kind of a series of workouts. And it's like, yay, you go through the workout, you feel sweaty, you did your workout, you're done. These are not workouts. This is a training program. This is written in a very specific way to get you stronger over time, to improve your form over time, to get the reps in like your brain of how training should look. So if you do like two or three of the exercises, but you're also going to the gym and doing other like maybe a strength training class, or maybe you have this routine that you already kind of like. Well, here's a good example too. You have this routine that you always kind of do with your weights in the gym, like 6 days a week. You usually go in your gym, you do this little routine that you have with your weights, and now you want to implement our program. So you're like, well, I'll do that little routine I do like 3 days and I'll do you four. That doesn't equal seven. Yes, it does. So I'm going to do these four ones and then I'm going to do these three little routine that I do. Don't do that. I don't mind you doing extra cardio. I don't mind you getting some extra movement in, but don't do any other strength training if you can help it, which I think you can, other than this program. And go into the program and lift with intention and focus on not necessarily trying to get your heart rate up, but follow the rest times that are in there. Watch the form videos. Try to get better. Try to get stronger. When you go into next week, which you'll notice are the exact same workouts as this week, repeated. They're going to repeat every single week. Upper one, two, three, and upper one and two and lower one and two are going to be the same each week. And there might be some change in the rep schemes or what we're asking you to do, but the actual exercise will stay the same. And there's a purpose for that. It's so that you can go and be like, oh, these again, what did I do last week? Oh, I did that. Oh, I wonder if I can do more. That kind of felt easy. I'm going to add 5 pounds to that. Whereas if you're switching around all the time, you don't have the ability to do that. And therefore you're keeping yourself stuck. You're not going to make progress, or you're not going to make progress as quickly as you would like, or as optimally as you would like. Okay. I had somebody message me from this bootcamp that was like, can I just say that I really appreciate this bootcamp? Like, I opened up the program and my first thought was like, I can do this. It's only 4 days a week with like this optional mobility day. Like, this is totally doable, because she's used to signing up for challenges or boot camps that are like every single day, some kind of high intensity thing. It's like 75 hard, right? They want to grind you into the ground. They want to get your before and after pictures. And then they want to send you on your way with zero skills so that you're just bouncing onto the next thing after that. So that's intentional. That's the point. This is how it should look. Okay. Some things that you can do to increase your success rate. Don't do everything once if you can't. So another common problem is like, okay, so even though this is manageable to somebody, for somebody else, it might be like, well, I'm going from doing zero things to trying to get to the gym 4 days a week. And I'm also trying to track my macros, which I haven't done in a long time. And I'm also trying to make sure I get 10K steps in, but my job, it's really hard to do that. And I'm also trying to parent and be a spouse or a partner on top of that. And I'm also trying to have a social life. And oh my God, I really also want to eat Oreos, but I don't know how to fit it in. You don't have to do everything all at once. And your success in this bootcamp is not going to be defined by how well you do everything all at once. It's going to be defined by how you show up and how you level up for yourself. So if you can only manage right now to get the workouts in and try to find time to go to the gym and try to get really consistent with those four workouts a week, and you can't handle tracking right now, and you want to just do a portion control until you can put the tracking on your plate, then do that. If you can only do two of the workouts every week and you really want to put your main focus into tracking, then do that. But you don't need to do everything all at once. Okay. So keep that in your mind. Another thing you can do to increase your success rate is meal plan. You have in your challenge guide a meal plan template. I gave you the literal link to download it on Google Drive, and it's awesome. Print it out, or you can just use it in Google Drive, make a copy of it, and plan out your meals. Because having that forethought of what you're going to eat, even if you don't have it necessarily prepared, but if you know what it's going to be and you have the ingredients and the things ready, even if it's McDonald's, I'm not lying. Like, if you know that Wednesdays are a shit show because so-and-so has baseball and so-and-so has swim and we're getting home at 9 and we usually end up running through the drive-through, then plan to run through the drive-through instead of telling yourself you're going to try to do better and then feeling guilty about running through the drive-through anyway. Just put it in your plan. Wednesdays, we go through the drive-through. That's totally fine, but plan for it. It's a totally different like way of going about it. And then guess what? If you know, there's two different ways you can go through the McDonald's drive-through. You can go into it with this guilty conscience, telling yourself all the things you can't have or shouldn't have. And that's going to lead to you getting the Big Mac with the large fries and the Coke. Okay, or Diet Coke because you're trying to, be better. Or you can go through the drive-thru with like, this is planned. We do this on Wednesdays because this is easiest for me and I can have anything I want and I don't feel guilty about it. Oh, guess what happens then? You actually don't even want the Big Mac and the large fries anymore. You literally don't even really want it. Sure, that sounds good, but all of a sudden, your mindset going into it causes you to be like, you know what? I'm gonna get the grilled chicken sandwich today. And I'm gonna get a Diet Coke and I'll get a side salad. Holy crap. And I'm staying on track. And any other week, I can go get the Big Mac if I want to, but I just don't want to this week. And guess what? Every other week, you probably won't either. And once in a while, you'll treat yourself. But the mindset is huge. So meal plan. And the last thing is if you're struggling, I want you to think of the consistency calendar. So this is also in your app. So go look if you are on the boot camp. But it's a general idea, and I would pull it out and show it to you, but I don't want to right now because I don't know where my phone is and I can't show it to you accurately because I'm not screen sharing. But it's a general idea of imagine a calendar, imagine 30 days, and imagine it broken into like little blocks of the weeks, right? Now I want you to imagine putting a check mark on every single day that you are consistent, that you hit your whatever it is you're aiming to hit. It doesn't have to be every single thing. Let's say it's getting your workout in and hitting your nutritional targets. Let's just say it's those two things. Every single day you do that. Every single day you get the planned workout in, even if it's an off day, you can check that off because you didn't do it and you weren't supposed to. So that's great. Check it off. And every day you hit your nutritional targets, whether it's macros, whether it's portion, whatever, check it off. And every time you don't hit it, whether you're way off track or a little bit off track, you just get an X, whatever. You didn't hit it, X. Okay. We talk about being 80% consistent because that's the most logical path to success is expecting 80% of yourself, 80 to 90, depending on the season. If you have 80% consistency, 83% consistency is five of those days with an X. So imagine a calendar where 5 days you're off track. 5 days, maybe one's a baby shower, maybe one's a work luncheon, maybe one was your birthday. Mine's on Saturday, so I'm thinking about I'm like all the food I want to eat. Maybe one's your birthday and you just want to like eat whatever you want, not track or whatever. Whatever, that's 5 days. Not that you necessarily should go off the rails, but 5 days where you have some wiggle room to not obsess about it so much. Okay, so I want you to remember that consistency calendar. And if you want to print it out, it is in your app. Some people literally need to print it out and hang it up and check it off. So if you can start checking off the things that you want to be more consistent at, that is a huge help. All right, we're going to get into questions here in a second. I want to tell you that next week's topic is Macronation. So we're going to be talking macros. We're going to be talking carbs and fats and proteins and calories and why and how and bleh. So we're going to talk about all that next week. Next week, we're also going to do the Halo Watch giveaway because the week after that, we're going to talk about like movement in general. So I want you to have like your Halo Watch so that you can track your steps. Cool. So let's get into questions. I'm going to do Zoom first and then I'll pop over to Facebook. Maria, I like looking at it that way versus daily. Oops, shoot. Somebody came in the waiting room. Yes, Maria. So there's lots of ways to look at the consistency thought. I mean, I was just talking about this with somebody else. This 80-20 can look a lot of different ways. You can look at 80-20. Sorry if you've been coming in on Zoom and I haven't been letting you in. Sorry, Monica. But you can always bounce to Facebook. So that's the bonus of this. You can look at it as, and you should probably look at it both ways, right? So I like to look at the 80-20 as like over a month. So if I'm 80% consistent. I kind of shoot for 90% to be honest with you, but again, depending on the season. So right now I'm trying to cut, I'm eating low calories and I don't like it. I'm aiming for like 90% consistency, maybe 95, because I really just like I really want to be dedicated, but that's not sustainable long term. Whereas in the course of my day, I'm trying to look at it like 80 to 90% consistent in terms of whole foods, not in terms of not being on my calories, right? So I still want to be within my calories, but for example, today I went to a luncheon, PTO luncheon, and we got our favorite restaurant that has my favorite mac and cheese, and I was totally going to eat that. Did it eat up a lot of my calories for today? Yes. Should I have maybe had not two servings? Probably. Am I going to pay for it later? That is true. But that's where the 80-20, like I'm not going to have, 100% whole foods today. I prefer 80-20. This is where the Oreos fit in. You can still hit your calories, hit your protein targets, and eat Oreos in your day. And I would argue that you should. The more Oreos you have, the hungrier you're going to be because you can't be hungry on 2,000 calories of Oreos, right? So lots of ways to look at it. This is a great question, Joy. How do you track weight on barbell? Is it barbell plus plates or just plates? This is totally personal preference. Some people like to track the entire weight because they want to see that big number every time they do it. I literally only track the weight I put on one side of the bar. So if I did a deadlift and I did a 45-pound plate on each side, I literally track that as 45 pounds because when I see that, I don't want to do math. Like today in my program, I'm going to bitch about Laura right now. I love you. She put that my total weight for deadlifting should be 190 pounds. So I had to stand there. I was like, okay, 190 pounds minus the weight of the barbell. So it's minus 145. And then I'm left with this number. And then I have to divide that in half. And now I have to, I don't want to do that every time I go in. So I only do one side of the bar, which was fine, Laura. I didn't mind it at all. Because I liked seeing how much total I was supposed to do. And I don't expect her to do my math for me. But that's how I do it. So it's totally up to you. Just make sure that the way you do it is the same every time. So don't switch it up, right? The tracking is for your purposes. So however it works for you. Sarah says she'll catch up later. Sounds good. Any other questions for you guys? That's okay, Laura. I didn't expect you to math for me. And it was actually fine because I actually liked seeing 190 because I know in my head that 210 is what I typically do. And so I liked knowing how close it was because when you just give me the side number, if you're going to tell me how much weight to do and you just give me it how I do it, then I end up adding it up anyway because I want to know how close it is to that number. So I actually didn't mind it at all, but it was just an example of my poor math abilities. Facebookers, I'm coming over to you to see if you have any questions. And Zoomers, if you have any questions too, pop them in. If you want to peace out, you're free to. We're just doing Q&A at this point. Oh, working out, not feeling well. Thank you, Christy. So this is going to depend. So if you just have a head cold, I like to say from the neck up, if you're not feeling well is from the neck up. And you feel like you have the energy and the desire, then I say go for it and just adjust intensity accordingly. If you feel like you can totally do a complete regular high intensity workout when you have a head cold and have it not impact you that much if you're feeling up to it, because sometimes those head colds can knock you out. So if it's from the neck up and you feel like it and have the energy, go for it, adjust intensity accordingly. If it's like neck down or like head all the way down. So if there's anything like else going on, if there's any fever, if it's anything like that, then steer clear. Or if you think it might be, like if your kid has strep and all of a sudden you're not feeling well, but you don't necessarily think it's strep, I would not. Any questions you guys have for me? Questions or comments? I'm not seeing all the comments on Facebook, which is annoying. If I expand. Okay, here we go. Cool. Nothing on Zoom. No questions, guys. You feel good going into next week? Week one's almost done. I had a good question actually that I'm going to pretend was a Q&A question right now because I think you guys could benefit from it. I had somebody ask me, like, I haven't been able to get in workout one and two, like, on time. What should I do? Like, should I go backwards? Or like, how should they be organized? So they're set up to, like, workout one is not going to necessarily translate to workout two. And workout two doesn't necessarily translate to workout three. So you don't, it's not like the skills you learn in workout one are going to build per se. It's more so week by week. So if you try to get in all four workouts in a given week, it doesn't really matter when you do them. You want to do them in order. But if you need to do Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday without a rest day in between and do the mobility at some point or not or skip it, that's fine. Sorry, I made it small. It went away. You can totally do that. We recommend a rest day in between, but it's not necessarily mandatory because they're up or lower. So you can get away with doing them back to back. If you skip a workout, we recommend just picking up with where you left off and keep, not where you left off, pick up with what you're supposed to do that day and keep going. Mainly because the purpose of this, she said that's what I was going to ask. Mainly because the purpose of this boot camp. Now with a client, I might say, go back and do, like, if you missed your one workout from last week on Friday, like start there and keep going. But with this boot camp, it's only 6 weeks. And then unless you stay on with us, which would be awesome, you're going to lose access to all of those. So there's no point in being behind. Just pick up with like day one, right? And keep going. Could you do upper and lower in one day if necessary, or is that too much? That's a lot. I mean, each workout's designed to be like 45 minutes to an hour. So if you're in a predicament where you can only do three workouts a week, then I would just cut out one and I would rotate them, like workout one, workout two, workout three. And then the next week, workout four, workout one, workout two. And then the next week, workout three, workout four, workout one, right? So I would just go through it like that instead of trying to combine anything. I think it's too much. It's possible, but I would only do it in very specific situations and only like once or twice ever. It's not something I would recommend doing regularly. I want to repeat that the nutrition is where you're going to see most of your results if you're fat loss focused. So I know a lot of you guys want to lose some weight, lose some fat for summer. You're going to see the most progress from doing that with your nutrition, from focusing on your nutrition. So don't overthink the training unless you're in a position to overthink it. Don't overthink it. Foundations. Okay. If you're getting something in, focus on your nutrition, and that's where you're going to see the most results. Sheila, I love the app. I'm still showing two workouts per day. I'm sorry. I think I accidentally, and not all of you, I accidentally double, like somehow layered your program. So there's two per day. I will try to fix it. It is fixable. I have to go back in everybody's program that I did that to and delete it. So do this because I don't know who's has it and who doesn't. Send me a message on the app. And I'll go in if you want it fixed, if you have that and you want it fixed, and I'll go in and I'll change it for you. Megan, what do you mean should I cut out today? Sorry, I minimized again. Megan, what do you mean if I passed on my calories yesterday, should I cut out today? Oh, like should you lower your calories the next day if you ate too many the day before? Is that what you mean? I'm gonna assume that's what you mean because there's like a 10 second lag on Facebook, so I'm not gonna be able to see it before I start. Yes, awesome. yeah, no, I wouldn't. So here's the thing. Here's the thing is this is again, this is like a preference. So with where I am right now, I'll use myself as an example. I am further along in this general. Well, I don't even know if I would use that as a good example. No, because I wouldn't do that. What I was going to say was that where I am with my level of training and nutrition and with being in a deficit and trying to get the scale to move, that I probably would. But then I actually don't think I would. I still wouldn't. I recommend no for most people because what this gets you in the mindset of is having to make up for something. It's kind of the same mindset of I ate, you know, a cheeseburger, so now I have to run on the treadmill to burn it off. It's obviously not that bad, but it's the same kind of mindset that we want to get you out of. So if you can do it in a way that doesn't affect you emotionally and you're able to continue on, then sure. Because scientifically, like the goal is to have your calories balanced at the end of the week. So there's actually a strategy of like calorie cycling. So purposefully having more some days and having less other days so that your average, it's all about the average at the end of the week. But what I don't like about, I like to either plan it that way and do it on purpose, but I don't like to go into the mindset of like, oh, it's almost like you're punishing yourself the next day. And I don't like that. And I find that even when people don't think that they're like, no, I'm going into it with a fine mindset. I'm not punishing myself. You kind of still are subconsciously, and it can lead to not, you know, not being able to do this sustainably. So scientifically, yes, you can totally do that. If you think you can do it in your mind and you think it'll be fine, I encourage you to always experiment with stuff like that. But my general recommendation is no, just pick right back up with where you're supposed to be today. Hope that answered that question. Any other questions? You guys feel good going into next week? Awesome. All right, cool. I'll let you guys go. Happy Thursday. I hope this was helpful for you. Give me a thumbs up in the chat box or in the comments on Facebook. Can you give me a thumbs up if this was helpful for you? Awesome. Thanks. You have to do that. What are you going to say? No? What are you going to give me a thumbs down? Maybe just stay quiet. I'm just kidding. I know it's helpful. Even those of you that are a little further along, it's always good to have these reminders. We don't do thumbs down vibes here. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. Vacation next week. I'll be pausing the program and not on the call next week. We'll get back on track when I return. Awesome. I love that. Jennifer, I love that you didn't, I love that you signed up anyway, because some people, that for them is like, oh, 6-week boot camp, I have to be 100% engaged. And it's like, it's your life. awesome. Good for you. Cool, guys. Have a great rest of your week. Have a good weekend. And I will see you in a week. Chat soon.
Record.
Thank you. I appreciate you. He does lie sometimes. I've caught him in lies before. So it's really hard to tell. Like, it's hard. And I don't, like you said, like, it's, I have the same questions because I don't have a lot of information right now. So I'm wondering the same thing. So it's really, that's the other thing. It's really hard to know how to react to it because I don't actually know what happened. It was like while they were waiting for the bus. I don't think it was when they were actually on the bus. Because he didn't even ride the bus home yesterday. I was like waiting for him and nobody, and he never got dropped off. I'm like, I started getting nervous. And then Wayne finally called me and told me that he had to pick him up. Yeah, so I that's a good idea, though. Thank you about meeting with the principal. And good for you for the mac and cheese. Something else I was thinking about, change the subject, with the whole programming, director programming thing. And it got me thinking about it when you're talking about that, the one girl who just wanted programming. And also, like, when Megan left, I was thinking about this when Megan left because I remember she messaged me and she was like, I don't know what to do. The person I used to get programs from won't return my messages. And she's like, and I want somebody to make me a program. But I don't really want to pay for like full on coaching. You know what I mean? And, cause she's like, I don't really need that. I just want someone to make me a program. And I so just wanted to write her one. I think she found something somewhere eventually. But so I was thinking, like, what if that's something like, and this, here's my insecurities again. You don't, obviously, if you don't like this idea, that's fine. And you don't have to do it. Don't have to do it. Hold on one second. Sorry, I'm outside and I had to make sure I was like still pressing the button down because I can't see my phone. I'm like, I better be talking and not just talking to nothing. So I was thinking of like, what if you, something that could be something we offered to like people who are pretty much done. Like, I know you have the light program, but what if it was like more customized programming and less of the coaching where we just offered them that and they could either buy it. Like, I don't know how you'd want to do it. They could do it like monthly or they could just like buy it per program or something like that. For somebody who's like, yeah, I don't really need coaching anymore, but I do like, because you can find programs online or whatever. And the only thing is they're not going to be like catered to you or like customized for you. Plus I feel like in the beginning, the programming doesn't matter as much. And as you get more advanced, it matters a little bit more. You know what I mean? So to make sure, you know, you're getting a good one.
Yeah, I like that idea a lot. let me think on how it would work. I didn't know that about Megan. I wish you would have told me that. Maybe we could have turned that around for her. Let me think about it. I don't want to think about it.
Yeah, this is very annoying. I feel you there. What I personally do, depending on obviously your rapport and what you've already said to this point, I usually am just really honest. It's like, you know, hey, Shelly, I love that you're tracking every day. That's fabulous that you're putting in that work. But it seems like you're not interested in being coachable to get to compliance. Is that true? And if so, what do you feel like is the block from getting you there?
kettle swings. You're wondering, Jamie, why kettle swings before deadlift day? This is a very specific move. And moves like this, powerful, powerful thrusting motions can really help. Powerful moves like this. Swings and moves like this, powerful, powerful thrusting motions can really help with your overall deadlift strength over time. It translates. The key with this is making sure that you're using a heavy weight and that you're only doing like 5 reps, maybe 6 max, because you really want to focus on the speed of the thrust, the speed of the movement, and making sure that it's perfectly executed. And the idea here is power, generating as much force as you can in a limited amount of time. And if we did like a super high rep of like a grab your muscles that you want to use, we do want to, and we don't want to do that, but the speed and power in the deadlift long term. Out of time. Calories for this shit. Meaning, which is 145.
So I need 72 and a half on each side. And this is 44. I need 44, 54, 64, 74, 28.
Chalk. So you know those dig kits that kids have where they can dig for like dinosaur bones or natural stones? I literally keep the chalk from that, and that's my gym chalk. Thank you. department. So these are fun. If you can get a landmine attachment for your cage, these are, you can open up a world. So these are fun. If you can get a landmine attachment for your cage, you can open up a world of fun new possibilities. This ankle. Wait, sit ups. I finished this off. I'm so done. Wait, sit ups. I finished this off. I'm so done. Get it in today, guys. Get it in today. Thank you.
like this, powerful thrusting motions can really help with your overall deadlift strength over time. It translates. The key with this is making sure that you're using a heavy weight and that you're only doing like 5 reps, maybe 6 max, because you really want to focus on the speed of the thrust, the speed of the movement, and making sure that it's perfectly executed. And the idea here is power, generating as much force as you can in a limited amount of time. One other example. Power, use a lot of attention and perfect your form each time versus just jumping and jumping to get your heart rate up and risking injury. I just want to show you what my deadlift day looks like today. I'm not eating enough calories for this shit. 44, 54, 64, 74, 28. You know what I like to use for chalk? So, you know those dig kits that kids have where they can dig for like dinosaur bones or natural stones? I literally keep the chalk from that, and that's my gym chalk. Pro tip. But again, you don't want to be doing this. be doing this plyometric, jumping up and jumping down, jumping up and jumping down. Goal is to be very focused, use a lot of power, use a lot of intention, and perfect your form each time versus just jumping and jumping to get your heart rate up and risking injury. Double swings and moves like this, powerful, powerful thrusting motions can really help with your overall deadlift.
Hey, what's up, Beatrice? The 100% answer to this is you need to optimize your metabolism. And some people call it reverse dieting. Some people call it maintenance break. I like to say optimize your metabolism because I want to look at it from multiple factors, right? So essentially what's happened is you have successfully lost 60 pounds, which is amazing, by the way. Congrats. But naturally, your metabolism is going to kind of downregulate to try to hold on. As the closer you get to your goal, the harder it is. And so I would really take a season to focus on optimizing your metabolism. This means eating more closer to maintenance, and also putting a lot of your energy and focus into strength training, lifting heavier, maybe getting some new PRs, et cetera, and really take at least like 3 to 6 months to do that before you revisit weight loss. And what's going to happen is you might actually notice continued weight loss when this happens, but a lot of it's going to be body fat loss. So obviously you're going to be gaining muscle and losing fat more at the same time. So you'll notice a lot of metabolic benefits from this, including probably continued fat loss. But then revisit, which will help you speed along your weight loss, right? But then revisit after you've spent that time period doing that, revisit fat loss again down the line, and it'll be a lot easier to kind of finish that off. So I hope that was helpful. If you need some help figuring out how to do this in your own life, let me know. I'd be glad to talk it through with you. Yes. So this is actually really easy. I know exactly what you mean. I was fearful of those things too, but if you get a weighted belt, so I'm assuming not a weighted belt, a belt that can hold weights, it's like had a chain on it. So if you have access to one, I'm assuming you do, just put a 5 pound plate on it. You'll be amazed. You'll think like, oh, I'm such a badass. I'm doing this weighted, but you'll be like, it's only 5 extra pounds. Like it's like if you gained 5 pounds overnight from water retention and then still did your weighted dips or your dips. So just add 5 pounds and just do it and just do as many as you can. And then try 10 pounds and just do as many as you can. And even if you can, if you're doing 10 already, you're going to be able to do like very close to 10, if not 10. And just keep adding weight a little at a time. And it's, and for pull-ups as well. I started doing weighted chin-ups and weighted pull-ups, once I could do 5 to 7 consecutive pull-ups. So if your main goal is kind of strength and increasing that strength, once you get to like 5 or 7 consistent, then when you add that little bit of weight, you'll probably do less, but you're still going to be within the range of like focusing on strength. So you might be able to get 3 or 4 instead of 5, 6, or 7. But that's fine. And then if you want to, you can finish out the set without the weight. But that is one strategy that you can do as well. So good luck. You're going to rock it. Post your progress.
Deadlift strength over time, it translates. The key with this is making sure that you're using a heavy weight and that you're only doing like 5 reps, maybe 6 max, because you really want to focus on the speed of the thrust, the speed of the movement, and making sure that it's perfectly executed. And the idea here is power, generating as much force as you can in a limited amount of time. So another example of this would be doing box jumps for power and strength in a barbell back squat. But again, you don't want to be doing this plyometric jumping up and jumping down, jumping up and jumping down. Goal is to be very focused, use a lot of power, use a lot of intention, and perfect your form each time versus just jumping and jumping to get your heart rate up and risking injury. I just want to show you what my deadlift day looks like today. I'm not eating enough calories for this shit. 44. 5 or 6 swings. And moves like this, powerful, powerful thrusting motions, powerful, powerful thrusting motions can really help with your. So moves like this, powerful thrusting motions can really help with your overall deadlift strength.
Thank you. Yeah, really well. I brought home a good amount of food for you guys. Mm-hmm. Yeah, she will. She asked me, so, can you give me some mac and cheese? So.
Oh, you know what else I got her?
The guy that was helping me take this stuff out, he had a crock charm that said Lubies. And I was like, is that a crock charm? Crock charm, the little charms that go in your crocks? And I was like, is that a crock charm? And he was like, yeah. I was like, oh my gosh, where did you get that? My daughter would die. And he was like, oh, we actually sell them. I was like, no way, can I get one? And he goes, oh. And then the other guy was like, oh, I think we're actually out of them. And he goes, wait, I think I have an extra in my car. And he went and got it for me. And he gave me a Luby's one. It says Luby's. And they gave me a literal crock charm that's just the Luby's mac and cheese. And then it's the Luby's strawberry cheesecake. So I got three. I was like, she's going to love that.
Luby's crock charm. Yeah. All right. Love you. Huh? Yeah, I already did. But I'll text him again. Yeah. I texted him this morning. All right. Love you. Bye. Hey, yes, this is awesome. How did that chalk feel? Is that good? You're like, look, I'm using the chalk. Awesome. Your form is awesome, but it is very much like a straight leg deadlift. So you're keeping your legs very straight, which the only difference is that you activate a lot more hamstring. So if you want to, so it's kind of split between the hamstring and the glute, right? You're kind of working both pretty equally. If you want to really kind of bias the glute a little bit more, you can bend at the knees more. It doesn't mean your knees come forward. It just means that you bend at that joint more, right? And shove your hips kind of more back and down a little bit. And you won't feel as tight of a pull in your hamstring. So just know the difference. There's like the classic RDL, which is kind of real shoved back. Like you're trying to shut the door of your car and your arms are full of groceries. So you really kind of, your butt's a little bit down and more back. And then there's the stiff leg version, which is kind of what you're doing, where your hips kind of stay high, your hamstrings get a really tight stretch, and that's going to, you know, give you a little bit more of a hamstring bias. Hello, sir. Do you like my GIF, whatever?
gosh, happy early birthday.
Wednesday's good. What time on Wednesday or Monday? Monday in the afternoon. Okay, that works. Me too. I hope you're not doing this while driving. You are, aren't you? But sorry, I got it in and I can text it to you too if you want to just add it in when you get where you're going. Okay, sounds good. And what is your email address? DavidPat, P-A-T. Oh, David@Bernie.com. Wow. Okay. That's easy. Awesome. All right. I got you and I'll put it, I'll send you a calendar invite too so that it's on there. We submitted the short-term rental application, so that's going through. But I guess our thing is we were hoping you could change our names on the contract so that we can sign it because our names are written wrong. Or my name's written wrong and his isn't on there. So those were the things that we wanted to adjust before we sign. So I'm not sure if you can do that. Okay, sounds good then. So then we'll just, we'll sign that and I'll talk to my husband about what you said as well. And then I guess we just have questions on decorating and stuff, but we're going to meet on Monday so we can cover all of that stuff when we see you. Awesome, David. Well, thank you. And I hope that you feel better. All right, bye. Bye. Not a huge deal. Like I said, your form is perfect. Like it looks amazing. It looks like amazing stiff leg RDL, but still a really good RDL.